thank God for this pastor. Good. Good, 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 good. Of course, there is no worship leader like Minister John. Minister John is just the best. So get his name anywhere. Consistently anointed, man. We really, really appreciate that. Of course, every pastor tries to get our band, but they can't have our band. We've got the baddest band in the world. Come on, give y'all praise for our band. I'm in the leadership of Brother Antoine! And the mom, Trav, an old man of the group, Brother Jesse. Flip that, the old man of the group. He's been here long with that. He's the senior of the group. He's an old man of the group. All right, let's go. One more time, give God praise for our first day. All right, I had to put your head out there, but all right, welcome to the 40 Club, Doc. Good, good. Of course, my mamas. Man, my mamas are the best mamas in the whole world. Talk to them and say, your mama. The best mamas in the whole world. Best mamas in the whole world. Deacons and teachers and preachers and all of you here. Of course, our First Lady Jane. First Lady Jane! I would honor First Lady Jane being here every night, lifting up that whole side over there, just keeping everything together, doing so many things behind the scenes, making sure things working, clicking, going together, orchestrating little stuff, managing little stuff, keeping fires away from me. I get in the car, find out, did you know the couple of decisions I made? What? Just doing that thing. Come on, give my First Lady a hand. And then, there's a young lady who's here every with her kids. You know what I'm talking about? That guy, get that young lady a shout out. She sit right over there, and she's just here every Wednesday with her kids, making them sit down, and they didn't get loud or whatever, and I just give God praise for her. And others of you were here, but I just talk about her. I mean, last but not least, I should be preaching now, I apologize. But this is my party. I take them all that way. I got to give Sister Tanya a shout out. And I know, Sister Tanya, I ain't gonna say nothing other than you all don't know what she's going through, and yet she's here every Wednesday and every Sunday. We honor God for you. We honor God for all of you that are present. All right, your visitor, would you please stand? Your visitor, would you please stand? Visitor, would you please stand? Look at God. All right. Give a great big old hand clap of praise. We thank you so much for coming being with us. I love your spirit too, worshiping over here. Thank you so much for being here with us. We want to encourage you, if you don't have a church home, please remain standing. All right, we got some stuff for you. If you don't have a church home, we'll encourage you to make this your church home. Amen. While you remain standing, we got some gifts that we want to give you. About $10,000 worth of stuff in there. Didn't really put the decimal point, but we're grateful you chosen to be with us. Give them a hand clap of praise again, if you will. Thank you so much. While you're clapping, let's clap for our visitors around the world. Come on, brother. Come on. Love on them. Love on them. We honor you. Honor you who watch this every week on our webcast, It's Web TV, PTNBC, wherever you watch us. We thank you so much for tuning in. If these services are a blessing to you, send us an email. We really would appreciate an email. Just drop us a little word and say, Pastor, keep going, church, keep going, our church, keep going. We're so grateful you chose today. I want to encourage you to come and be with us any Sunday, 9 o'clock for our Sunday school, 10 o'clock for our morning worship. Be so grateful if you would come and be a part of our services. One more time, prayer time. We'll give our visitors from around the world a praise. Last but not least, Sister Sophie this morning in our Sunday school is just sick. And Sister Sophie is a teacher. Par excellence. You are fantastic. God has certainly gifted you with the gift of teaching. Amen. So Sophie is at 9, Sunday school started at 9 o'clock. 9:01, she's already at level 10. And she don't come down until 9:35, 40. But it was fantastic. You all are missing some great lessons from our teacher. God has given me a wonderful chasm of preachers and teachers. Some pastors don't have that. I'm blessed that I do. I have anointed in both groups. Amen. And I thank God for you. You'll hear them over the next few weeks or so. As you know. All right, Ursus, thank you so much. Grab your Bibles real quick. We want to go back into customer service. Brent V thinks we're ending this series today. We're not ending this series today.
I think that's pretty good.
John will be preaching next week, and he's going to do part 10 of whatever part we own. Amen. John's a great preacher. Great preacher. You all don't sleep on Minister John now. I know his worship drives you crazy, but he's a great preacher. You already know he ain't going to lose his life over no rap. You already know that. Amen. And then we got teachers during the week. Sister Daggins will be teaching on Wednesday. Amen. And then Jones will be on next Sunday chewing on the cud. Y'all know that about him. He'll be chewing on that. Amen. And then Sister Sophie and Deacon Spears. And some others. And then we just go let God do this thing. All right. Just turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 18 and we'll get there in a second. We've been talking about customer service according to God. Customer service according to God. Say that with me. Customer service according to God. And I put that little piece in there because, you know, some people say, well, customer service ain't in the Bible. That's a corporate term, man-made term. And they are right. It is not the word customer service in the Bible. But you will see inferences of customer service in the Bible. As a matter of fact, I believe that the Bible is one big customer service book. It's a handbook on customer service. Those of you, well, all of us, I don't care where you work, all of us, you have a job, you have a set of customers. Yeah, you do. Even if you work in a cubicle by yourself, your report goes to somebody. Your whatever you're doing goes to somebody. Or if you work in retail and restaurants, the public comes to you. But there are often times that if you work in a cubicle, you work in an office setting, your customers may be another department. Isn't that right? If you work in the accounting department, then your customers may be the managers. We have to send you the report so that you can do payroll or whatever the case may be. But all of us have customers. Amen? Your neighbor is your customer. Yeah, in September, we're still in the series. I'm going to show you how your family are really a set of customers. Customer service to your wife, customer service to your husband, customer service to your children, all those kinds of things. So God is speaking to us as it relates to customer service. We already defined it as the process, the method, the practice of ensuring customer satisfaction. But I want you to understand we're doing this so that we can get right here. It is to increase your consciousness in three areas. The type of customer service we what? Offer what? And each other. All right. I want you to increase your consciousness with the type of service you offer to God, customer service of God, ourselves, and each other. I'm going to use my R word, and I've used it now for a few weeks. I'm saying it again. None of these three deserve raggedy service. None of them. Come on, say this. Say, God deserves the best. Say, my neighbor deserves the best. Now say, I deserve the best. Even you got to treat yourself a certain way. Amen? Because what? Nobody will treat you better than you treat yourself. No. All right, so God deserves the best. We deserve the best. And the people we sit next to, the people we work with, deserve the best. Does that make sense? All right, so now, in order for us to give each of these entities the best, then we have to become conscious of the type of customer service we give. It is not fair to be a super duper employee for your workplace, but be a lousy member in church. That's not fair. It is not fair to iron your clothes for work and school, but come to church wrinkled. It is not fair. It is not fair to be on time for work and school and stuff, but always late for church. not fair. It's not fair. It's not fair. It's not even fair for you to be late to everything and then have the nerve to get mad at your hairstylist or the bank or whatever because they run in a few minutes late. It's not fair. So the customer service we give to ourselves really speaks to the customer service we give to each other and ultimately the customer service that we give to God. God is first. That's the thing that we want to be conscious of. That God deserves our best. And so there should never be a moment in your life, there should never be a moment when you come to church where you are not giving God the best that you have to offer. If you're well enough to come to church, you are well enough to give God praise. I'm going to say that again. If you're well enough to come to church, you are well enough to give God praise. I don't care if you have a headache, I don't care if your leg hurt, your left knee hurt, whatever. If you're here, there's enough in you to give God some sign of it. You got to do this, do that. But whatever you do, don't do this. Let every child show some sign. If I had 10,000 tongues, I'd use them just to praise his name. Is that right? Yes, we've got to always be conscious of the kind of thing that we give God. Now, in Matthew chapter 18, Jesus again talks about another facet of customer service. In Matthew chapter 18, Jesus talks about another facet of customer service. I want you to look at verse 21. He talks about another facet of customer service. He's about to give them the customer service policy on forgiveness. And when he does it, Peter says something to him in verse 21. Verse 21, it says, then came Peter to him and said, what? Shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Pastor Jones told you. He said, question mark, gotta stop. So that's the question. Then he comes with another. He says, till seven times? And then Jesus said unto him, here's the policy, customer service policy for forgiveness. He says, I say unto thee, what? Colon, but what? So here's what Jesus says. Peter says, how often shall I forgive him? Seven times? And then the Bible says, Jesus said unto him, seven times? No, man. It's until 70 times. 70 times. 70. How often are you supposed to forgive your brother? Seven, or somebody say you don't stop, or somebody says the number really resets itself. But how many of us forgive our brother or sister 70 times 7? Or an infinite amount of times. How many of us forgive our wives, forgive our husband, forgive our children 70 times 7? Is there a limit to your forgiveness? You think that great. Yeah, it should be. But many of us have 70 times, 70. It ain't gonna even be three times. It ain't gonna even, you better not pick me three times. I'm done. Some of you was one time. He come at me wrong one time, I'm out. She come at me wrong one time, I'm done. Or one more time. She says the customer service policy on forgiveness is what? 70 times 70. And when he gives this, now Matthew doesn't put this footnote in there, but Luke does. Luke says when Jesus told him this, Luke 75, the apostle said unto the Lord, what? Increase our faith. In other words, Lord, hold on, Lord. Are you really saying 70 times 70? And he said, in Luke, they said, Lord, yeah, increase our faith now. Has God ever asked you to do something? You had to say, Lord, you increase my faith on that. I know you, God, and you all know, because General's told us that you're not omniscient and I'm not present, but Lord, you got to increase my faith on that. If that ain't never happened to you, it's because you ain't. But anyway, so there are times in your life God will tell you to do something that you do not have the faith capacity at the time he tells you to do it. And that is because, and this ain't got nothing to do with sermon, but that is because God never speaks to our right now. God speaks to our where we're going. So God will call you things in the future that you're not there yet. And sometimes the only way to grab what he's saying is to say, Lord, increase my faith. You ain't sliding there. Let's get on back to Matthew chapter 18. So he says, they say, Lord, increase my faith, because this idea of 70 times 7, Lord, oh my God, how do you pull that off? How do you pull off forgiving somebody 70 times 7? How do you pull off forgiving somebody where the number always reset itself? How do you forgive somebody where, watch this, you stop counting? Preach, Reverend Johnson. They say, Lord, how do you pull this off? And it must be a hard one, because they said, Lord, increase our faith. But in Matthew chapter 18, Jesus must have heard their expressions. And the Bible says right after he says it, he goes into how they're going to pull this off. Preach, Reverend Johnson. So in Matthew chapter 18, verse 23, he says, all right, 22, he says, forgive 70 times 7. But 23, he says, all right, here's how you're going to pull it off. Therefore, is the kingdom of heaven like unto a certain king, which what? All right, verse 24, and when he had begun to reckon, what? All right, so the Bible says that there was a king who had a debtor. Preacher Evan Johnson. And this debtor owed him 10,000 talents, which was a unit of measurement. In the NIV version, it really translates to millions of dollars, but I ain't gonna lose you on that, so let's keep it real simple. He had a debtor who owed him $10,000. Somebody say $10,000. Now, here's the question. How are we gonna pull off this 70 times 7? Jesus goes into this parable and he says, here's how we're going to do it. There's a certain king who had a debtor, and how much did the debtor owe? $10,000. Now watch this. The very next verse says, what's the condition of the debtor? Verse 25, he says what? But for as much what? The debtor has the same problem a lot of us have. He didn't have it. Tell your name, say, you didn't have it. You ever had a bill collector call you and you didn't have it? Am I talking to anybody in here? I know I lost half my audience. Some of you always had your bills paid. Some of you woke up with credit cards. You were born with credit cards attached to your skin. But for the rest of us, we ain't always had it. That's why I thank God for payment arrangements. Come on, can I get a little help right here? I know the church down the street ain't gonna shout on that, but
I wonder if I got at least 50 of y'all who will shout over payment arrangements. Come on, don't play it off. We all own them. Come on, high five your neighbor and say, thank God for payment arrangements. Ooh, sometimes that's the difference between a steak and a bologna sandwich. The payment arrangement. But you sit here and act like you ain't never heard of payment arrangements, like that whole concept is just vaxxed towards you. What are payment arrangements? To God be the glory for the times they let me do a payment arrangement. Yeah, I know I got some shouters in here who've left the place glad you were able to put a little something on it. You mean all I got to do is put this on and then you ain't going to cut my lights off? What you doing? I'm just shouting over some payment arrangements. Whew. Where would you be without payment arrangements? Well, the man in our text, he was not offered any payment arrangements. The Bible says there, in verse 25, it says, he didn't have nothing to pay. And when he didn't, it says, his Lord commanded him what? Now, in the ancient Middle East, there used to be something called debtor's prison. Yeah, now the current equivalent would be if a brother didn't pay his child support. Yeah, and if you didn't pay your child support, you know, they garnish and all the kind of stuff. But if you don't do that, you know, they come and pick you up after a while. Well, imagine if DTE could do the same thing. And y'all already know Comcast crazy. What would your credit score be if you thought you were going to go to jail if you didn't pay that bill? How much more would you pay your bill if you knew they were coming after you, your wife, and your kids? Some of you win now. Hold on. How long they go? Let me think that through. Yeah, debtor's prison was a prison where they could get you, they can get your wife, they can get your children, and they would lock them up to a degree until they worked off the debt. Now, it was your debt, but because you didn't pay, they could come after you, your wife, and your kids. Now, I know today all they do is shut your lights off, hit the button on your cable and your cable's gone, and that's a whole different pressure than knowing somebody could knock at your door and take your wife and your kids and you and say, all y'all come with me, y'all gonna be in prison for the next 4 or 5 years until you work off this. How much? $10,000. Somebody say, thank God we don't have debtor's prison no more. Other than the child support area. And I know a couple of brothers going to shout on that privately. You just shout on that privately. Just go ahead and get your... Listen, the Bible says, verse 9, he did not have anything to pay. And the Lord commanded him to be sold and his wife and his children and all that he had until payment was made. And then in verse 26... the Bible says, the servant therefore fell down and did what? Oh, don't read the rest. Well, go ahead, read the rest. He worshiped and did what? The Bible says that the servant fell down, and I love this, worshiped him. This began my first clue to know we got to be talking about Jesus here. Now watch this. The man did not have money to pay the debt. But he knew there was something about worship that could change his circumstances. The Bible says he didn't have money to pay, but he decided to worship God. See, this is reason 58,000 you shouldn't stay home when you're going through. Because worship can do something that money can't buy. Come on, touch your neighbor and say, I might be out of money, but I am not out of worship. I came to wonder if I got 40 people in here who know how to worship while you are broke. That's what I love about worship. It don't cost money to worship. You don't know what your neighbor got in their pocket based on their worship. Somebody worship and they might have a money full of pocket. Somebody worship the same way and might be broke, because worship can do something that money can't buy. Watch this. Worship can do something that prayer can't do. Look at the text. The Bible says he worshiped, and then it says, and he said, Lord, have patience with me. I will pay thee all. And because he worshiped him, in verse 26, verse 27 said, then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and did what? And loosed him and what? If you don't shout right here, you got to be out of your mind. Brother Kev, the man did not ask for the debt to be taken away. He just worshiped God. And when he worshiped, worship gave him something he didn't ask for. I don't know about you, but I'd make up in my mind whenever I get in the presence of God, I'm going to worship him, because I don't want God to just forgive the debt. I want God to give me something that I did not ask for. Touch your neighbor and say, you better learn how to worship. You better learn how to worship. You better learn how to worship. One of the reasons you have all the things you're going through is because you have not learned how to worship. You got to learn how to worship. Worship doesn't change the debt. It changes the heart of the creditor. Why are you worshiping? Because I'm trying to change the heart of the creditor. And when you go to church and you worship and you don't have the money, do I have any witnesses in here? I know you've been late on your DTE bill, but won't they come up with something else even though you blew the last payment arrangement? I found your neighbor say, I know that's right. Come on, I've blown a couple. I've blown a couple of them arrangements, but because I worship God, I call them back up, and some kind of way they work out something, and sometimes it's cheaper than the payment I was just paying. Excuse me a moment. You got to learn how to worship God over the payment arrangements that he does when he changes the heart of the credit. Touch your neighbor and say, learn how to worship. That's why you better not come to church and fold your arms and broke. Fold your arms and broke. Be quiet and broke. Let the redeem of the Lord say so. He didn't have no money to pay. Bible says he worshiped, and the Lord not only loose the debt, but he forgave him of the debt. Thank God for Jesus. It is in verse 28 that the text changes the tension. And for the next 10 minutes, that's all I want to talk about, is the change in the tension of the text. Because here's what's happened, Dean Gardner. The man was freed of his debt, which means his wife didn't have to be locked up. His kids didn't have to be locked up. He didn't have to be locked up. He didn't even need payment arrangements like we need. Totally forgiven. But here's what the knucklehead does. In verse 28, the Bible says, and this is a preach, the same servant. Somebody say, the same servant. The Bible says he went out and he found his debtor. Let me preach, God. And he owed, how much did he owe? But his debtor only owed $100. NIV version translates to $1,000, but for the sake of our discussion, $100. Now, he owed $10,000. But his debtor owed what? $100. And the Bible says that when he saw his debtor, it says he went and, look at this, 28, laid hands on him. And it's in the Bible. What did he do, Sister Waters? Are you kidding me? What did he do, Mama Lockridge? He grabbed him by the throat. And look what he says. Pay me my money. Right? He didn't do that. That's a good effect. Pay me my money. Pay me my $100. I just got $10,000 freed. But you're going to pay me. My $100. This takes me, and I'm done, to rule number 9. The 9th rule of customer service. A customer service rep must remember they were once a customer. Can we go home? Touch your neighbor and say, I'm not only a rep, but I'm also a client. Oh, glory to God. You got to get this, because the problem we have in the body of Christ is people forget where they came from. The reason you treat me like you treated me is because you forget where you came from. I can't stand the person who act like they have been perfect their whole life. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, we all done raised up some debt. I struggle with a person who act like from the moment they were born, everything was smooth and cool, and they never had to have any moments to break down. But I'm talking to at least 152 of you in here who will admit, I have owned some debt in my life. Still owe some. Touch your neighbor and say, I'm also a client. I'm also a client. I'm also a client. When it comes to God's grace, I'm a client. When it comes to God's favor, I'm a client. When it comes to God's unconditional love, I am also a client. The man in our text forgot he was also a customer. He forgot he was a client, Sarge. He forgot where he came from. And the problem we have in body of Christ when it comes to customer service is many of us forget that we were on the other end of the phone at some point in our life. You weren't always in church. Some of us were. Some of us were raised in church and we just learned how to sin in church. But some of you will admit you ain't always been in church your whole life. So it don't make sense. I don't know why the man who used to smoke cannot be patient with the man who's still smoking. I didn't say tolerate it. I didn't say endorse it. But why can't, if God delivered you from smoking, how come you can't lay in the cup with your brother while God's delivering him from smoking? The only way you could do that is if you forgot where you came from. So Some of us were wild when we were young, and now you can't stand the fast version of yourself. You've got to remember where you came from. Touch your neighbor and say, I was also a client. Huh? I was also a client. You got to remember that you were a customer yourself. Told y'all years ago, bill collectors called house. Thank God I've been delivered from that. But years ago, they called house. And I'm telling you, the best, absolute best bill collectors who would always get some money out of me, even if I ain't have it, were those who would be on the phone and would say, I know where you've been because I've been there too. My heart would melt and I'd come up with $20. Here's $20. I know it ain't a lot, but here's $20. Sister Barbara, something happens when you deal with somebody who's already been through that. Something happens to the customer service relationship when you're dealing with somebody on the other end of the phone who's already been there and done that. There's a cyclical synergy that takes place in the confines of the conversation when somebody's on the other end of what you're going through saying, I've already been through what you're going through. I can relate. Nobody wants their car to break down, but if your car broke down, wouldn't you feel better if the auto mechanic said, the same thing happened to my car? Nobody wants to be sick, but don't you feel better if your doctor said, I had the same problem happen to me? One of the things that got us through with Elise initially, her initial diagnosis, was the nurse who came up to us and she saw my wife crying and she said, hey, y'all gonna be all right? How you know we gonna be all right? This is where she got us quiet, because she said, I got a daughter who went through the same thing. Something happens when you deal with somebody who's already been through that thing. And many of us in here, all of us in here, have been through something, watch this, that God has forgiven us for. Here's the revelation in the text. Jesus is saying, if I can forgive you for $10,000. Lord, how are we going to forgive 70 times 7? How are we going to forgive 70 times 7? How are we going to pull this off? If I can forgive you for $10,000, you ought to be able to forgive somebody $100. He seems to be suggesting little stuff we're asking each other for forgiveness for cannot compare to the stuff I forgave you for. touch your neighbor and say, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you. I know they ain't do nothing to you. I just wanted you to hear how that sound when you tell somebody, I forgive you. Now, here's the question. How do you want God to forgive you? Do you want God to forgive you, but bring it back up again? Somebody say customer service. Do you want God to forgive you, but keep a little note on it just in case I gotta use it a little bit later? Do you want God to sort of forgive you? We not only want God to forgive us, but we want him to take that thing and throw it in the sea of forgetfulness. Am I making a little sense in here? Now, Jesus says, cool, I'll forgive your $10,000. But I need you to be able to forgive that little $100. I just lost half my audience right there. Somebody say customer service. Because if we want God to forgive us, we got to learn how to what? Forgive others, or more importantly, forgive each other. so that you forgiveness will always be hard when you forget you were a customer. When you forget God has forgiven you, the man in our text forgot. He seemed to have lost sight of the fact that he was just forgiven. And if God can forgive us 10 minutes ago, and I want you to think, now here's the part, you ain't got to say nothing. Don't say nothing. Just think about the stuff in your life that we have done to God and he forgave us. Just think that through for 5 seconds. Just think that through. The stuff we did that we didn't think nobody saw, but he was there all the time. The stuff we did, he forgave us, and we did that thing again. Now God says, if I can do that for you, you mean to tell me you can't forgive a lie? You can't forgive the stuff you're going through? Only person who would do that is somebody who forgot where they came from. Touch your neighbor, say, I'm also a customer. That's what I love about Jesus. Jesus is also a customer service rep and a client at the same time. Hebrews chapter 4:15 says, we do not have a high priest who is not touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but in all points was tempted just like we are. He was a rep and a client at the exact same time. As a client, he got tired. But as a rep, he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. As a client, he would be prone to getting sick, and he would be prone to struggle. But as a rep, he said, cast your cares on me, because I know how to care for you. As a client, he knew how to be the Son of God. But as a rep, he knew how to be the Son of Man. We had a Jesus who was able to do both at the same time. What God needs us to do is to learn how to be a customer service rep and a client at the same time. Touch your neighbor, I'm done, and say, whatever you do, don't forget where you came from. The inference in the text seems to suggest, watch this, those who sin the most should be the ones who are able to forgive the most. Why it seems like those who were the worst sinners are the people who judge the most. Why is the man who drank his whole life can't stand a young brother who's drinking, he just got started? Because he forgot where it came from. I'm done. I see a look on your face. And there's only one piece of inquisition we got to settle in the text. Because now you got it. You say, all right, I see what's going on. He went out and treated the man same way. But there's still this fatal footnote we've got to contend with. And that is, if you look at the text, both men had a few things in common. You'll notice that both men had debt. You see that in the text? One had 10,000 and one had 100. Uh-huh. Both men couldn't pay.
Yeah, they couldn't pay. Couldn't pay.
Yeah. And both men asked for patience. They didn't ask for the debt to be forgiven. They just asked for patience. Mm-hmm. Now, here's the quagmire in text. If they had all this in common, what distinguished the nature of the debt? What made one owe 10,000? And one owe $100. Why? is there a certain sin that's $10,000 worth and another sin that's only $100 worth? Is this text telling us that sin has to be evaluated on a certain level, that when it comes to murder, that's $10,000. But when it comes to lying on your taxes, that's $5,000. But when it comes to backstabbing, that's only $50. Is the text suggesting that we get a discount for cussing folk out? How did one man end up with $10,000 and another man with just $100? Now, the Catholic faith would answer this for us. They, in the Catholic faith, they have categories of sin. Catholic faith, they have what's called mortal sins, and those are $10,000 sins. Those are grave offenses that only the Pope can forgive you. And then there are venial sins. Those are what? Easily forgiven. That'd be the $100 sin. A couple of Hail Marys and talk to the priest and a couple of penance, and you can get rid of the venial disease, but not the mortal sins. So is this text trying to teach us that they're right, that sin has to be in certain categories? One $10,000 sin and the other $100 sin? No, because we know that sin is sin. But if that's true, why the relative value on the different distinctions of debt? Because the text is not teaching us the value of sin. The text is teaching us the value of grace. God is not saying one sin versus another costs more. God is saying, when it comes to your sin, I paid more. Preacher. The reason you ought to be excited in this place is because when it came to our sins, God left no stone unturned. God said, I am going to redeem you no matter the cost.
I don't know why y'all should be shouting right there.
Let's break it down further. When you think about all the things that you've done, from the time we met Jesus, we all ran up a debt. The Bible says, hold on, that the wages of sin is death. Which means that every time we sin, we raise the debt. When I met Jesus, I already owed him $10,000. Is there anybody in here who can be honest and say that when you met Jesus, you had already owed him $10,000? If the truth be told, there's some of you in here who say, I owed him more than $10,000. I came to tell you that even though you owed him $10,000, God said, I'm not going to let nothing separate me from redeeming you from the wages of sin. Is that all right in him? And so the Bible said that even though we owed him $10,000, when we met Jesus, Jesus said, bring me all your debt. And when we brought him all our debt, I heard mom and them say that a long time ago, Jesus paid it all. It didn't matter the cost. It didn't matter how much I sinned. It didn't matter who I was. But Jesus redeemed need, and I owed a pretty big bill, and that's why every time I come to church and wave my hand, I'm just trying to pay a little something on it. Every time I come to church and say hallelujah, I'm just trying to pay a little something on it. When you see me preaching down here, I'm just trying to pay a little something on it. But I heard the songwriter say that you can't be God-given no matter how hard you try. Is there anybody in here that knows it don't matter how much you pay on it, you could never be God-given? But Jesus came along and he forgave us and washed the slate clean. And I'm so grateful in him that God forgave me $10,000. And you mean to tell me that I'm going to let God forgive me for $10,000, and I can't forgive you for $100? Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, today I forgive you for your $100. Come on, touch three people and say, I forgive you for your $100, because whatever you did to me, it cannot be more than what I did to God. And God forgave me. He never stopped loving me. He never stopped talking to me. He never stopped looking out for me. He never stopped blessing me. And if God can do that for me, I ought to be able to do the same thing for you. Just touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, today I treat you the way God treated me. Well, how can God treat me? He looked beyond my faults and he saw my needs. Your neighbor ain't perfect, but you gotta learn how to look beyond their faults and see their needs. And where you can help them with their needs. Is that all right in here? How did you make it? It was nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sin? What can make me whole again? High five your neighbor and say, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Come on, stand to your feet and say, neighbor, remember where you came from. Remember where you came from. Remember where you came from. The worst customer service rep is somebody who don't remember where they came from. I don't advise this, but years ago, bill collector called and he said, I owe them money. I said, your company owe the government money too? I said, you asked for a bailout. Where's my bailout? It didn't work, so don't try it. But anyway, I had to remind him where it came from. Listen, your customer service skills will be 1,000 times better if you remember where you came from. The reason you struggle with customer service is because you don't take into account that God forgave you $10,000. And you sitting here tripping over $100 or $10. 10 minutes ago stuff. God has forgiven us for some stuff that you can't even tell your neighbor about. Touch your neighbor and say, I can't tell you everything. I can't tell. Woo. Now somebody go, woo. Come on. I'm finna shake the room. I'm finna shake the room. Just touch your neighbor and say, thank God I just wasn't caught. I dare you go, woo! Hallelujah! I said hallelujah! It ain't that I was perfect. I just wasn't caught. And God forgave me, listen, for all of that. And he didn't even treat me like I used to do that. And here we are, sitting next to your neighbor. They did something 20 years ago. You still mad at $100 worth of stuff 20 years ago. You have sisters, your biological sister, your biological brother. You stopped talking to them over $100 worth of stuff. And God has forgiven you for $10,000. Get yourself together in Jesus' name. Only difference between you and your neighbor is they got caught. They got caught. How can we not forgive each other? I'm done. Lord's Prayer says this. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Do you really want God to forgive you of your debts the way you forgive your debtors of their debt? Just think that through a sec. The Bible says 70 times 7. And the only way you can do that is to remember where you came from. It's easy to forgive somebody 70 times 7 when you know you serve a God who's forgiven you 700 times 700 times 70 times 70 times 7 plus 490 plus. Grab your neighbor's head. Bow your heads. Father, in Jesus' name, we are all customer service reps. Yeah, we are, because you said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven. We're all customer service rep because you said we are a city that sits on the hill that cannot be hid. We're all customer service reps because you said, let your light so shine before men. And so, God, we ask that as we go through this series, you will change the consciousness of the customer service we offer. It is not right. It is not fair for us to expect you to forgive us $10,000 worth, and we can't forgive each other $100 worth. We hear the explanation in the parable loud and clear. Help us to be the type of customer service reps you're calling for. Help us to remember that we all once were, still are, customers of your forgiveness policy. Help us to do better. We're holding hands. And somebody's holding the hand of somebody who needs to forgive their mother. Haven't spoken to their mama in years. Over $100 worth of stuff. Somebody holding hands, somebody who hasn't spoken to their father. Over $100 worth of stuff. Some person holding hands ain't talking to their neighbor. Haven't talked to their sister, their brother. They're holding grudges over $100 worth of stuff. But God, in Jesus' name, if you can forgive us for $10,000, give us the consciousness and the demeanor to be a customer service rep that honors your forgiveness policy. 70 times 7. Help us to lose count. Just like you lose count on us. In spite of our sins, you keep using us. In spite of our sin, you keep blessing us. In spite of what we did, you keep receiving us. In spite of what we did, you keep loving us so much so your word said nothing can separate us from the love of God. Help us in Jesus' name to do the same thing to and for each other. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Amen. Thank God. Let those hands go. Give God praise. I need you to hug. I need you to hug at least 3 people and say, don't forget where you came from. 3 people. Tell them, don't forget where you came from.
You thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed.